It's the summer of 1984, and as the West Indies take to the field against England, under Captain Clive Lloyd, a new world order in cricket is about to be confirmed. England's batsmen face a fearsome, fast bowling attack.
Cricket, lovely cricket.
Oh, dear me.
This is how I saw it. England has tried their best, but West Indies has won the test.
Good ball.
Getting out of bed, you know you're going to face Holding, Ghana, Marshall. You thought, well, where do you hide?
Oh, he's gone, caught behind. Gower goes straight after tee and Ghana.
Matching the ferocity of their bowlers is the awesome batting power of Vivian Richards.
But what you got here is power. Power. Power.
Magnificent hit. There it is, 100 for Vivian Richards, and a beautiful stroke with which to bring it up.
This was more than just a series of test matches for the West Indies. Those involved knew that a special kind of pride was at stake in what they did on the pitch.
They want the West Indies team to win every match they play so that they can walk around feeling proud to be West Indians and go to their workplaces and walk in there feeling as if they are somebody and they mean something.
For West Indians, cricket has been part of a struggle to escape a history disfigured by racial conflict and the legacy of empire. When politicians have failed them, they have turned to their cricket team for a sense of nationhood. So when in 1984, Clive Lloyd's team completed an historic 5-0 series victory over England,
and he's caught, it's all over.
This was the peoples of the old empire striking back in a way that all West Indians understood went beyond the boundary.
It didn't begin with Viv Richards. This thing is a long, long story. There's no shortcut. There's much more to West Indies cricket than just hitting a cricket ball. Yeah.
Marshall has 7 wickets.
In a superb exhibition.
And Sobers welcomes him with typical aggression.
Wesley Hall, the world's proud one down against England.
And what a triumph for the West Indies and their passports.
Cricket has been described as the glue that binds the West Indies together, creating a sense of a single West Indian identity. It is the only test-playing nation which doesn't represent one country. Consisting of 10 sovereign nations, from Jamaica in the Northern Caribbean, the West Indies form an arc of islands, including Barbados and Trinidad, down to Guyana on the northeastern coast of South America.
It is very important because it's one of the few things that we do together. Although they're islands, it'd be bringing one nation together. They all have their own flags and anthems and so on. So to play under that one banner of West Indies cricket, it's an exciting one, but very challenging.
There is strength in this cultural diversity, which can be seen in the way West Indians play the game.
If you start at the top of the archipelago, Jamaicans bring, and Antiguans bring an aggression and a huge confident talent. As you go around, you come to Barbados and you find graft and concentration. The proper Bajan will never get himself out when the score is 25 for 4. Now a Trinidadian will hit that ball for 6. He'll either be out huge or be a huge success.
But when cricket first arrived in the Caribbean in the 18th century, Black West Indians were excluded from the sport. Like every aspect of society, cricket was in the grip of slavery and intended for whites only.
Black people would not have been allowed to play. However, they had a role peripherally. They would be sent to retrieve the ball from the ubiquitous cane fields. There were cane fields everywhere.
The physical strength needed to work in the cane fields meant the slaves developed a more athletic physique than their white masters, and they identified returning the cricket ball as their one chance to demonstrate this power.
they would have imposed this on themselves, as trying to throw the ball back as far as possible and as accurately as possible back to the wicketkeeper or fielder, something of the sort. As the game developed, they were called in to bowl to the white batsmen. And this now became a big challenge, that here at last, I've got a license to bowl to Massa, the man who owns me. This is one arena where I could now confront him not just as an equal, but probably even as somebody superior.
After slavery was abolished in 1834, black West Indians began to be called to play alongside whites, who needed them to make up a playing 11. By the turn of the 20th century, black and white were playing together. And in 1906, one of the first West Indian teams to visit England included black players. But the racial stereotypes which divided West Indian society also dictated the roles played on the cricket field.
The tradition of West Indies cricket spoke in terms of a division of labor on the game of play along lines of race and class. Batsmanship was seen as the art of the white player. The fast bowlers were seen almost as if they were laborers, and the young black men would be the fast bowlers and the outfielders, and that was how the game was framed.
Out of Trinidad in the 1920s emerged a cricketer who would challenge this apartheid.
Larry, Larry Constantine, Larry, I never bowled a body line. Honesty and integrity are the sum total of Sir Larry.
Leary Constantine learned to master every part of the game on Port of Spain's Savannah pitches.
Here was a man who could bat number four, who could open the bowling and field at cover point. It was an absolute phenomenal achievement. He was a complete and all-round player.
Constantine's bowling, batting and fielding were all executed with a flair and panache which set the template for how West Indians would play the game.
He was a showman, but he represented the model for West Indies cricket. This was how we were going to play our cricket. We were going to play aggressive cricket. We were going to play creative, artistic cricket. We were going to be athletic in the field. Our fast bowlers must have long runs and must bowl quickly. And the batsmen must be very different from the British batsmen. They must be creative, play all the strokes, and they must be entertaining in the process.
Constantine was part of the West Indies team which travelled to England for their first test match in 1928. Captained by former army officer R.K. Noones, Constantine knew that it was inconceivable that a black West Indian could lead the team. But the West Indies were beaten 3-0, and Constantine soon began to feel that a black captain was needed for the team to progress.
Cricket in the West Indies is the most obvious example of the black man being held back. And West Indies cricket will never reach its full potential until it has a black captain.
Constantine inspired black West Indian cricketers, and in the 1930s, a specialist batsman from Jamaica surfaced. George Headley challenged the stereotype that only white players could bat at the top of the order. In 1935, Headley, batting at number three, scored an unbeaten 270, leading the West Indies to their first ever series victory over England in the Caribbean.
He was a tremendous player, one who proved to West Indians that we do have players here who could really compare with any, and even the great Bradman, because everyone said Headley was the black Bradman. People here said no, Bradman was a white Headley, and so on. And of course, being a black Jamaican from a humble background, that made him more of an icon because the masses could identify with him.
Headley and Constantine were the first cricket heroes to black West Indians, and their achievements on the field inspired confidence that it was time too for political and social change.
what the cricket is really in fact doing, it is reflecting the desire of the community to say to Great Britain, we have been colonies for 300 years and the time has come to redefine our political relationship to Whitehall. Independence is in the air. The trade union movement is demanding the end to the colonial relationship. There is a middle class movement speaking of sovereignty, constitutional break with the British Parliament. So the cricket and the politics are intertwined.
Through the 1930s, demands for political independence and social reform gained momentum. As the white elite resisted, the situation became increasingly volatile, and a series of demonstrations and general strikes swept across the region. But any hope for change was put on hold with the outbreak of the Second World War.
People in the morning said, and tell them I am coming, so they better prepare for war. People in the morning said, and tell them I am coming, so they better prepare for war. Tell them murder, kill and slay, war declare at the break of day.
West Indians fought alongside British troops to defend the empire. But when the war ended, the soldiers returned to find that many black West Indians still lived in poverty. One of those to grow up in these ghettos was batsman Everton Weeks from Barbados. The cricket he played there as a boy trained him to play his shots along the ground.
Actually, I was born just about 200 meters away from here, Kensington Oval, and I played most of my cricket in that corner there. The houses were very close together. If the ball went through somebody's window, you know, you were given out, sort of thing. That was one of the reasons why the ball was struck underground.
But as a poor boy from Bridgetown, Weeks had limited opportunity. Just as West Indian society was still divided between black and white, cricket clubs were also segregated. Clubs like the Wanderers in Barbados would remain exclusively whites only until the late 1950s.
It was not like South Africa. In fact, South Africa, I thought, would have been better, where you knew that you shouldn't walk on that side of the road. And here was a little more subtle. You weren't accepted in certain places.
Frustrated by this apartheid system, middle-class blacks set up their own organizations like the Empire Club, which was established in 1914. But they refused to admit players without professional qualifications. Weeks, who had left school at 14, was left with the option of joining the British Army to play cricket. After making his name as a batsman for the Army, he was called into the West Indies team when test matches resumed in 1948.
That was one of the most delightful things that would have happened to me when I was asked to play for the West Indies.
And later that year, on a tour to India, Weeks set a record for West Indian batsmen, scoring 5 consecutive centuries. Now rated as the number one batsman in the world, Weeks was part of the West Indies team which prepared to tour England in 1950.
London is the place for me. London, this lovely city. You can go to France or America, India, Asia or Australia, but you must come back to London City.
This tour held special significance, as 2 years earlier the SS Windrush sailed from Jamaica, bringing a first contingent of West Indians to Britain. Its arrival began an era of mass migration of West Indians looking for a new life in the mother country.
But this is the place I wanted to know. London, that's the place for me.
And West Indies cricket was also entering a new era. Although still led by a white captain, this team contained a new generation of black cricketers who would go on to dominate Caribbean cricket for the next decade. Weeks, along with fellow batsmen from Barbados Clyde Walcott and Frank Worrell, would become known as the 3 W's.
Those players were great players to watch. They were, all had their own style. They were different. Clyde Walcott played on the back foot, very strong on the back foot, very good hooker. Frank Worrell was stroke the ball, very stylish.
And for the first time, this team also represented diverse cultures in the West Indies. Leg spinner Sonny Ramadan from Trinidad was the first cricketer of East Indian descent to play for the team. His presence was a breakthrough for the Indian communities in the Caribbean. They had been brought to the West Indies by Britain to work as indentured labor when slavery was abolished.
They had made significant achievements financially, economically, professionally, educationally, and so on. But to have a great West Indian player, that was the hope, the aspiration of every group in the West Indies.
But in the first test of the series, the West Indies were thoroughly outplayed by England, who condemned them to a crushing defeat.
Cricket, lovely cricket. At last where I saw it. Cricket, lovely cricket.
1-0 down, the West Indies arrived for the second test at Lord's as definite underdogs.
Goddard won the test.
But Sonny Ramadan, bowling in tandem with off-spinner Alf Valentine, shocked England. They took 18 wickets between them, spinning the West Indies to their first victory on English soil.
The bowling was super fine.
Winning in England at Lord's in 1950, this had never been achieved, and I thought that that was the highlight of my Test career.
When the final wicket fell, jubilant West Indian fans followed calypso musicians Lord Kitchener and Lord Beginner onto the field for a victory parade. Their song became an anthem for West Indies cricket, and the press now labelled the players calypso cricketers.
At Lord's was the scenery, it bound to go down in history. After all was said and done,
for the rest of the series, the three W's tormented the English bowlers. In the third test at Trent Bridge, Worrell and Weeks put on a record partnership of 283. They went on to win both this game and the final match to seal an historic 3-1 series victory.
It came at a time when West Indians were immigrating to England, and when they got there, they were struggling. So the West Indies team triumphing in England at that time was a great boost to West Indians in England. But it also was a great boost to the West Indian movement towards self-determination in the West Indies. At that time, politically, West Indies were moving towards independence from Britain.
In 1958, Britain agreed to grant federation status to the West Indies. The hope was that these disparate Caribbean territories could forge a political and economic union and eventually gain full independence as a single West Indian nation.
It was surely the greatest day in the history of Trinidad. All Port of Spain turned out in the intense heat to cheer Princess Margaret as Her Royal Highness slowly drove to the Red House to inaugurate the first federal legislature of the West Indies.
But while the road to self-government was now opening up, the cricket team carried on being led by a white captain. And it wasn't as if the West Indies had built on their epic victory in 1950. They had since suffered defeats to Australia and England, with only the three W's continuing to prove their status as world-class players. In 1957 at Trent Bridge, Frank Worrell's 191 not out was hailed as one of the finest innings seen in England since the war. But they still lost the series 3-0. Worrell, though, had emerged as a natural leader, and black West Indians now had a serious candidate for the captaincy.
There was a self-confidence that not only could they govern themselves, but in the equally important matter of West Indies cricket, they should captain themselves. We've come into the 1950s with many people being very bitter, especially beyond the boundary, where this political revolution had taken place, but there was still unfinished business on the field of play.
The authority of the white elite was being challenged at all levels of West Indian society. In Trinidad in February 1960, at a test match against England, a riot erupted. An outraged crowd believed that a controversial run-out showed the umpires were favoring the old colonial masters. a month after the riot, West Indian writer C.L.R. James published an open appeal for Frank Worrell to be instated as captain.
Frank Worrell is at the peak of his reputation, not only as a cricketer, but as a master of the game. Respect for him has never been higher in all his long and brilliant career.
The authorities finally relented, and Worrell was appointed captain for the West Indies tour to Australia in November 1960.
That was really a great turning point. You know, now we can be all selected on merit, and yes, we accept that there are going to be batsmen or bowlers from each ethnic origin coming in, and that would help us to be stronger as a team and a unit.
Leading his team off the plane in Australia, Worrell was fulfilling a dream for Black West Indians begun by Leary Constantine. For the first time, their cricket team would be chosen on ability alone. Worrell assembled a young side featuring batsman Conrad Hunt and Rohan Kanai, and fast bowler Wes Hall. He wanted it to represent the Federation's new spirit of unity, and even included former captain Jerry Alexander. Also on that tour was a brilliant young all-rounder from Barbados. Gary Sobers had already hit the headlines 2 years earlier when he broke Len Hutton's record test match score. His 365 not out against Pakistan was the first test century this 21-year-old had scored.
And when I got to 364, I just pushed the ball in the covers, and before you look up, Clyde Walcott was down on me. I took off and ran down the other end, and the record was broken. The crowd was so overjoyed, and for about half an hour they were out there lifting me up and cheering.
With Sobers now established in the team, the West Indies travelled to Brisbane for the first test against Australia. It was Worrell's first match as captain, and the result would become part of cricket folklore.
The team captains, Richie Benno of Australia and Frank Worrell of the West Indies, tossed before the start of the first test match.
Worrell won the toss and chose to bat first. But Australia struck early and the West Indies slumped to 65 for 3.
Kanhai, Court Grout, bowled Davidson for 15.
When Worrell walked out to join Sobers in the middle, he knew the course of the match now hung in the balance. The pressure was on the captain.
Play resumes with Benno bowling his first over, and Sobers welcomes him with typical aggression. This sizzling straight drive takes the score past the 100.
Worrell, playing a captain's knot, is restraining his natural aggression.
With their backs to the wall, Sobers scored 132, and Worrell played a captain's innings with 65. Together, they had pulled the West Indies back into contention.
It's a full toss, and McDonald bangs it through for another 4 runs.
But the Australians replied strongly, and as the two sides both looked for the win, little separated the teams after almost 5 days of stylish and attacking cricket. The game was poised for a dramatic finish, with Australia needing 5 runs off the last 7 balls of the match, with Richie Benno facing Wes Hall.
Wes was ripping in. It took about 8 minutes to bowl the last over. They were 8-ball overs in those days. And Frank Worrell had given Wes strict instructions not to bowl a bouncer to me because I was a reasonable hooker. But not this day, because he did bowl a bouncer and I got a top edge and thought it for a moment it was going to fly over Alexander's head, but it didn't.
Benno's next and he's out, caught by Alexander. The 8th Australian wicket has fallen and either side can still win the match.
With the next 3 balls, Australia scrambled 2 more runs as they chase victory. Wes Hall missed a run out and then a catch.
The 5th ball, Grout swings, the ball goes high in the air. Hall races across and he drops the ball. The 6th ball, Meckiff connects and the ball flies deep in the outfield. They complete a 2nd run. The scores are level. The 3rd run will win the match.
Mecco full slogged Wes to deep mid-wicket. Conrad Hunt chased it. The groundsman there apologised to me earlier. He said, there's something wrong with the mower. I haven't been able to cut the clover. And this thing stopped in the clover a couple of yards from the boundary. Conrad Hunt picked it up, and they're going for the winning run, and the throw had to be within an inch of the stumps, otherwise Wally Grout would have been okay.
Grout makes a great effort, but the bails go off and he's run out.
With the scores now tied and pressure mounting, Worrell had some advice for Wes Hall.
When Frank whirled about to him and says, "The only thing I have to tell you is if you bowl a no ball, you know what would happen. You will not be able to go back to the West Indies."
Ball bowling the seventh ball to Klein.
And that is when Wes Hall said, and he planted his foot about 4 feet behind the crease to make sure that there wasn't a malignant umpire out there. And when he bowled it to Joe Solomon at square leg, we thought it was all over, because square leg is the hardest place in the world to hit wickets from, because all you can see is one stump.
And here's the single that wins the battle.
And for Joe Solomon to hit that one stump was absolutely remarkable, knowing that the batsman was going to run under all circumstances.
This was the first tied test in the history of the game, and it set the tone for an enthralling series. Despite eventually losing the series 2-1, Frank Worrell was hailed by the Australian press as an inspirational leader and applauded for the exciting brand of cricket his team played. The campaign to appoint Worrell had been vindicated.
And we drove through the streets of Melbourne, thousands of people. People don't want us to leave. West Indies cricket start to rise from 1960.
Back home, they were hailed as national heroes. There was now optimism in Caribbean society that with the cricket team and the federation, the West Indies could look to the future as a single independent nation.
This was a scene at Palisades Airport as a crowd of over 2,000 people awaited the return from Australia of four of the Jamaican members of the West Indies Test side. The people of Kingston, and indeed of all Jamaica, wanted to applaud these sporting representatives of the Federation.
But after only 3 years, cracks began to appear in the unity of the Federation. Jamaica and Trinidad wanted a greater share of the political power, which they argued reflected their greater economic contribution. These differences threatened to undermine the union. In 1962, the Federation officially collapsed. And later that year, Jamaica and Trinidad were granted full independence of their own. Leading the West Indies to England in 1963, Worrell knew that his team were now the only ambassadors for West Indian people. Cricket, more than ever, would have to represent the West Indies. Worrell kept the core of the team that had toured Australia. But he also added Charlie Griffith, who, with Wes Hall, would form a fearsome opening bowling attack. Together, they began the West Indies' reputation for aggressive pace bowling.
When Cowdrey is at 19, another blow for England, and for poor Cowdrey himself, struck on the forearm.
The West Indies outclassed England, winning the series 3-1.
The end of Stewart, caught by Solomon off Hall.
And in the final test at the Oval, West Indian fans raced onto the pitch to greet their heroes.
The Oval can never have known a scene like this. Victory in the series by 3-1 confirmed the West Indies as the most powerful side in the world.
After the tour, Frank Worrell retired, and the captaincy was taken over by his young protege, Gary Sobers.
King Cricket, Garfield Sobers is his name. King Cricket, Sobers is his name.
Sobers was the obvious choice, as he had established himself as the greatest all-round cricketer of the era.
He was, if not the best batsman of the time, close to that.
His attempted bouncer is majestically smashed by Sobers to the boundary.
If he was not the best fast bowler of the time, he was close to that. he was certainly one of the best spin bowlers.
The king of the game.
So he made a tremendous difference to whatever team he was playing in. You know, it was obviously a much stronger team.
For cricket and West Indies, long may he reign.
Sobers went on to score over 8,000 runs and take 235 wickets. He also wrote himself into the record books by becoming the first player to hit six sixes in an over.
And he's done it!
Sobers was tagged by the English press as the ultimate calypso cricketer. But into the late 1960s, the West Indies began to lose regularly, and Sobers was made the scapegoat.
I think the geniuses make very poor leaders because they are so self-contained that they are not capable, I think, of comprehending the complexities of mere mortals. As long as the team still had with it the great talent of the Frank Worrell team, it was okay for Gary. But once that team began to fall apart, Gary's weaknesses as a leader became very transparent.
Sobers retired with the West Indies in decline. Their commitment to playing entertaining cricket was now interpreted as a lack of discipline and mental toughness.
Let's go, boy.
Good luck, Stephen.
Aye.
Good luck, Morris.
Thank you, Leo.
Playing with Sobers on his final tour was a young batsman from Guyana who was now given the task of leading the West Indies.
Magnificent hook shot out of the ground. Superb shot there by Lloyd. The West Indian crowd on their feet.
Clive Lloyd was a powerful stroke player, but he identified calypso cricket as a negative stereotype, and he wanted to bring new levels of physical and mental strength.
The discipline that was needed for West Indies cricket is that we, you know, I didn't like this calypso tag, you know, calypso cricketer. I never liked that tag at all, and I wanted us to be professional.
In 1976, Lloyd led the West Indies to England. His regime insisted on team unity and togetherness, and he brought in a new generation of players like fast bowler Michael Holding from Jamaica and batsman Gordon Greenidge from Barbados. And for the first time, two cricketers from the small island of Antigua were included, pace bowler Andy Roberts and batsman Vivian Richards.
They were all great players. They started together, and we didn't change our team that much. And anybody that came in had to conform to our professional attitude, whether it be training or whatever we did.
Lloyd also introduced a new system of rooming arrangements.
Always had a bowler with a batter. You never had two Barbadians together. You had a Barbadian and a Trinidad. So they became friends. And,
can you write a commercial that not all West Indians look like that, like malnutrition?
We weren't paid an exorbitant amount of money, but money was not our main thing. We wanted to be successful. We wanted to make the West Indies people proud.
The previous year in Australia, Lloyd's young team had been humiliated 5-1 by a powerful Australian side who gave no quarter to their opponents.
And he's caught it in brilliantly, yes, by Mark. Bowled him. Bowled him. It's all over.
The hammering the Windies had taken confirmed to Lloyd that the West Indies team needed to toughen up. Before the series began, a chance remark by England captain Tony Greig riled Lloyd's players.
And I remember seeing him looking kind of pompous and, you know, making this statement.
You must remember, the West Indians, these guys, if they get on top, they're magnificent cricketers. But if they're down, they grovel.
He went on to say, and it's almost as if it was an afterthought, that he didn't want to focus only on himself.
And I intend, with the help of Closey and a few others, to make them grovel.
We said, oh, okay, let's see who will be doing such grovelling now.
To make them grovel, grovel, grovel.
I probably know more about facing West Indian fast bowlers than most, because having made that silly statement that I was going to make them grovel, they, I think, bowled faster to me than they bowled to anyone else. And they did give it to me. They got stuck in, and of course I was the one who ended up grovelling.
Bowled him, and that's well bowled by Michael Holding.
We are the West Indies! We are the West Indies!
Greg's comments politicised the tour for West Indians living in Britain. A generation after the Windrush had arrived, they were in some of the worst housing and the poorest paid jobs, and faced discrimination in their daily lives. They also had to deal with aggressive sus laws used by police to stop and search black youths, and the rise of openly racist far-right groups. Batsman Viv Richards had lived in England while playing for Somerset and experienced racism firsthand. For him, cricket became a way of making a statement of solidarity with his fellow West Indians.
I can remember there was a vacancy for a particular flat, and it was written quite boldly, no Irish or black. All these are reasons to state this statement that if you are so better than I am, you'll be able to cut my ass when it comes to cricket, and you didn't.
Richards arrived for the first test at Trent Bridge, knowing that a good batting performance from him would help boost West Indian self-confidence. Walking down the road with the pistol in your waist, Johnny and two
men. Viv was good. And Viv knew he was good, and Viv wanted other people to know that he was good. When he walked out to the crease, the swagger that he walked out there with, not that he was boastful, but that he was trying to impose himself on the opposition.
And if he walks to the wicket and he's calm, he sometimes, I get the impression, he deliberately finds something to upset him. Because when he's upset, he's at his most dangerous. And trust me, there are times when I'm at the other end and he's batting down there, and I, you know, I felt intimidated.
And there's another four, and it's a great shot.
I have a regret in saying this. I don't think there's anyone on earth who is better than I am. So whatever you saw, what the way Vivitz has walked out, because I'm proud. It wasn't an arrogance of such, I'm proud. And I just wanted to send that proudness that I'm here to stay, and God has given me this, and I'm going to administer it the best way. The only way you're going to do it is to shoot me dead. I didn't mind that either.
Short, beautifully put away. And short, not it. 200 in a test match on this ground. Following in the... That's in there. It could be a catch this time. Greg's there and he's made no mistake. Tosses it high. And Richards is out. A superb exhibition by this brilliant West Indian cricketer, Vivian Richards. And adding his name to the long list of great West Indian cricketers we've seen in this country since the war. Weeks, Worrall, Walton, Sobers, Lloyd, and now Richards.
Viv did represent something that spoke of black self-esteem, black self-respect, and black pride. He was a very political cricketer.
In the final test at the Oval, Richards scored another imperious double hundred.
And that's it. So Richards going on to a second double century.
And England were decimated by the whispering death, Michael Holding, who took 14 wickets. Again, clean bowling, Tony Gregg.
Oh, well, power.
Lloyd's Windies team sealed a 3-0 series victory, and it was now Greg's turn to grovel.
To give him all credit, when he was walking off the field for the last time, he went down on his knees and crawled the last few steps because the spectators, the West Indians in the stands, were giving him hell.
From 1976, the West Indies seemed unstoppable, beating all the teams in the empire of cricket and winning a second successive World Cup in 1979.
And it's all over.
Despite their successes, the team were not highly paid. And after they had won the World Cup, Lloyd was approached by the West Indies Cricket Board with a derisory offer to his players.
So Clyde Walcott came to him and said that he had been authorised by the board to pay him £50 as some form of remuneration for their victory. And he was just so appalled at it. He said it made him almost want to cry.
This financial insecurity threatened to undermine the unity of Lloyd's team. And in 1983, 18 West Indian players were offered a lucrative one-off deal to break a Commonwealth agreement and play in apartheid South Africa.
Mattis, Clark, Croft and Rowe are among the players reportedly earning up to £70,000 each.
The big money on offer meant many, like fast bowler Colin Croft, would risk a lifetime ban from Test cricket.
In a sense, it was a bad decision on my part. But also, I never considered myself what I would call a professional cricketer. I played cricket professionally, which is a different thing in my head. Because in those days, there was no money in sport. You got to play, you enjoy yourself, and then somebody throws you by the wayside, and that's the end of that. You got to beg somebody for a job. Well, I decided a long time ago I'm not begging anybody for a job.
But the majority of Lloyd's team refused to tour South Africa and stayed loyal to their captain's commitment to black solidarity.
We were never going to go there. Although we were offered a lot of money, it was obvious, but money was not all there. It was pride and belief in getting things right in the world. And sportsmen of such, I think we play a very important part in trying to get things together. And so there's no way I was going to go there for love or money.
This setback only served to make Lloyd more determined. Through the 1980s, the West Indies improved every aspect of their cricket. Introducing a specialist fitness coach, they now trained like professional sportsmen, and the team swept all before them with ruthless efficiency.
And he's gone this time, caught it slim.
This team had a winning mentality, but executed it with style and swagger.
I see 600 on the board here at Edgbaston.
It was an era that was dominated by, I would say, just power play. You know, quick bowlers, aggressive batsmen, brilliant fielding.
The most dominant teams in the history of the game have always built their success around fast bowlers. Lloyd's innovation was the ability to field not two or three, but four world-class pacemen, who each presented a different challenge to the opposition batsmen.
Getting out of bed on a morning when you know you're going to face Holding, Roberts, Garner, Croft, maybe substitute Marshall for Croft. It's an effort to get out of bed.
Cricket, lovely cricket.
Oh, dear me.
And you've got a bat against Michael Holding. You know that Mikey was probably danged out the quickest of their quartet. Great big long run-up, so you had lots of time to look at him. And he'd sort of come closer and closer very quickly towards you. But he had the most fluid action, pure silk. Everything worked. Everything was timed perfectly. And if it came at you at 95 miles an hour, well, it was on you mighty quickly.
Good catch. Draw ball too. Gower has gone.
Joel Garner with the extra height. And Joel could still bowl 90 miles an hour. It wasn't as though he was, he was 6 foot eight and the rest of it in his hand, therefore was, 10 foot, 9, 10 foot, up there. So he generated bounce at whatever pace, whether it was mid-80s or 90s.
And he's bowled him. So Gower goes for naught.
And then when Malcolm Marshall came through, Malcolm became maybe the greatest of them. He could swing the ball, he could cut the ball, he could bowl it quick, he could change his pace, he could bowl at the speed of light, he could attack you. You thought, well, where do you hide?
Well, that's begone. This is a very fast over from Marshall.
My thoughts coming up against any batsman was not really to try and impose myself on them mentally. It was all a matter of technicality, what this guy didn't like.
And a look at that, and he's gone, caught behind.
If I didn't think he liked a short ball, I'd give him a short ball. If I didn't think he liked balls pitching outside the Austin, coming back into him, whatever I think he did not like, that's what I would be trying to do.
And he's caught, it's all over, Alisson is gone.
In 1984, England, led by David Gower, were blown away by this pace attack, losing the series 5-0. Joyful West Indian fans now insisted that this wasn't just a series whitewash, their old colonial masters had been blackwashed.
And West Indies very convincingly win the series by a margin of 5 test matches to nothing. Blackwash,
blackwash. The West Indies power cricket didn't endear them to sections of the English press, who were finding their domination hard to accept. A barrage of criticism was launched.
I don't think our players are out to injure people. It's no doubt about that. They were quick, and if you have fast bowlers, you're going to get hit. It's no doubt about that. It happens here now.
The carnival culture, imported into English grounds by West Indian fans, irritated some in the cricket establishment. The authorities, citing safety and public order, began to ban all musical instruments.
That drum will spoil the enjoyment of the day for many, many people who are sitting here and having a...
And ticket allocations to West Indian fans were also subject to restrictions.
The ticket system became where you couldn't have two West Indian fans sitting together. So they were all very sporadic. And being sporadic, you couldn't hear them in numbers. Well, I felt it was a bit harsh. Jealousy. Jealousy.
When Lloyd retired, Vivian Richards took over the captaincy. And 2 years later, in the Caribbean, the West Indies silenced the critics, again beating England 5-0. Their dominance was rubbed in the final test in Antigua, where Richards wrapped up victory with the fastest ever test 100 off only 56 balls, a record which remains unbeaten.
People often ask me about the highlights of my cricket career. And I mention those two series where we won 5-0. And the reason why I mention that is because, not only because we beat England 5-0 twice, but because of the effort that was put in, the highly professional nature of the team. And I felt at the time the team was invincible.
This is not a one-man job. It's like guys who were in the trenches, World War I or II, whatever period of war, they see themselves as a band of brothers, and the accomplishment factor felt great after that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Led by Richards, the master blaster, the Windies continued as undisputed world champions. And in 1991, when Richards walked out for an emotional and final farewell at the Oval, he departed as the West Indies' leading run scorer. At the same time, batsmen Gordon Greenidge and Desmond Haynes, wicketkeeper Jeff Dujon, and fast bowler Malcolm Marshall also retired. These players had carried the hopes of West Indians through an era of nationalism, which had seen all of the Caribbean islands become fully independent. By the time these players had retired, the Caribbean was adjusting to a dramatic shift. The age of nationalism had given way to the realities of a new globalized era. Having achieved political independence, these small countries struggled to compete with the world's larger economies. The result was rising inflation and unemployment. In this new world, it was no longer enough to cling to notions of black pride and identity.
For a lot of us, it is a real challenge to get through the day, get something to eat. That's not an exaggeration. You know, Trinidad has a lot of money, but for a lot of people in Trinidad, there's a lot of suffering. Real poverty you can't imagine.
West Indians turned, as they have always done, to their cricket team for inspiration.
that's running away over the outfield into the fence for four. What a start by Lara.
In 1993, Brian Lara from Trinidad hit the headlines with 277 against Australia. But rather than the physical destruction wrought by Richards, Lara relied on quick footwork and perfect timing.
One player I wouldn't want to get going against us is Brian, because once he gets going, he controls the pace and the momentum of the game so well.
And got a great shot.
His footwork, his back left, flair, consistency, scoring big runs is just unreal.
Lara showed a single-minded determination in his batting, and in 1994, against England, he set his sights on breaking Gary Sober's record for the highest ever test score.
I was playing last test against England, 1994. We'd already won the series, good batting track.
If there is a record that is attainable, Brian will have a go.
Where maybe you'd say Viv, I think he was a better batsman, but Viv was only driven to dominate. So if he could dominate for a period, see his team to a good position, the record, wherever it stood, had no interest to him. Whereas Brian would add that to what he wanted to do.
And there's his 150.
But I have a sneaky feeling that he set his stall out from the minute he got to about 150. His brain works at a phenomenal speed. I think he would have done his mathematics in his head and set his stall out from as early as that.
Here comes Chris Lewis to Brian Lara. He's gone for a pull, and there it is. Brian Lara's done it. The ball rockets into the boundary.
Sobers was one of the first onto the field to congratulate him. Lara had played with typical finesse and style and was finally out for 375. And later that summer, while playing for Warwickshire, Lara went further, smashing the record for the highest ever first-class score with an unbeaten 501.
Somebody to make 500 in a first-class game, you know, teams don't make that, full teams. If a team makes 500, it's a monumental score for a team. And yet Lara had the mental strength and the ability to do that. Hardly ever perspired, hardly ever looked tired when making those runs. He was something else, he really was.
By breaking these records, Lara attracted worldwide attention. With a global market for cricket expanding, he exploited his new celebrity status.
This is now the age of globalization. This is now a different political and economic world. And Brian straddles these two worlds. He reflected the commitment, the anxieties of the nationalist period, coming after Viv Richards and Clive Lloyd. But at the same time, he took the team and cricket into the age of mass television, internet property rights, the player as a commodity, an entrepreneur, and he became certainly the Caribbean's first millionaire cricketer.
But despite Lara's individual success, the West Indies team was beginning to show signs of decline. And in 1995, they lost their first series in 15 years to Australia, who now became the acknowledged world champions.
And he's gone! And
that's the surprise of losing to Australia at Sabina Park, the whole dejection of it gave a flat feeling. There was a sense of disbelief, I think, that permeated the Caribbean as well. And it should have formed the determination to spur us on to greater things, but I think we were going down a path at the time as a region in terms of cricket that we didn't realize how serious it was.
In 1998, Lara was appointed captain with the hope that his individual achievements could inspire the team to success again. But ahead of the first ever West Indies tour to South Africa after apartheid ended, Lara led a players' strike, refusing to tour until the board offered the players more money.
All I can say is that what has taken place is very unfortunate. The decisions from the board, you know, it's something that we did not want. And We just have to hope that things can work out in the near future because we want the South African tour to take place.
The board eventually backed down, but the dispute highlighted a shift in priorities for this generation of West Indian players who were no longer content to play for pride alone. Watching this crisis unfold was Clive Lloyd, who had been appointed manager for the tour.
It's damaged world cricket, this, though, hasn't it?
I wouldn't say that.
But it has caused damage, hasn't it?
Oh, it hasn't caused it. We had a little problem and we sorted it out.
But you nearly didn't tour here.
Well, nearly never killed a bird yet.
We messed it up badly. This was the first official tour. We were looking forward to it for this for ages. And I thought that the leaders of that band of players didn't realize the importance of what, you know, our cricket was all about, our cricket in general. And they made a mistake there, and a very, very bad one.
Hold him! The tour was a disaster. The Windies were humiliated by South Africa, losing the series 5-0. Having dominated world cricket for so long, the West Indies suffered a dramatic slump, barely winning a match over the next decade. And the record-breaking Lara was blamed.
Miscue, caught mid-arm, Donald wins the battle in the end.
His achievement should have been the catalyst for setting the so-called rules on how West Indies cricket could make that turnaround. And I'm afraid to say he didn't do that as well as we thought.
But as a batsman, Lara continued his extraordinary run-making. And in 2004, he set a new test record with 400 not out against England.
Batty to Lara. There goes the sweep. There it is.
Exhausted from the expectations on him, Lara retired in 2006 as the leading run scorer in the history of the game. But he left with West Indies cricket in disarray, having failed to win a test series in 5 years. And in the Caribbean, there was frustration as West Indies society continued to be beset by social and economic divisions.
What has descended upon the societies is a kind of hopelessness, a kind of disillusionment about what their leadership was supposed to have provided, a kind of despair that their fortunes will not change, and a sort of a cynicism about where the societies are going.
Great catch!
And I think they feel the same thing about the cricket.
Today, a new generation of cricketers still turn out to practice and dream of future Windies success with bat and ball. Maybe here is a future genius, a Sobers, a Holding or a Richards, or even an inspirational leader, a Worrell or a Lloyd. And the current West Indies side are trying to recapture past glories.
That is a gorgeous delivery. Taylor has done what every man in the West Indies...
Whatever happens on the field of play and in the wider fortunes of the Caribbean, the West Indian team still remains the region's most important focus for pride and identity.
The West Indies have won a famous victory, all out 51 England.
With them, as ever, comes hope and dreams beyond the boundary.
Highlights of today's World 2020 match between England and Pakistan on BBC One later at 11:15. And tomorrow afternoon, after one, live ball-by-ball coverage of the tournament continues on 5 Live Sports Extra. And then for the rest of the week, you can see the evening highlights programme here on BBC Two at 11:20.